Hello, I'm Bobby Galuba with OobaTech.com. It's Tuesday, September 29th, 2015, and welcome to my 8th video, recorded on Saturday, September 5th, 2015, and Sunday, September 6th, 2015. In this video, I'm going to show you how to do an oil change on a 2003 Chevy Avalanche. So let's get started. Okay, so it's Saturday, September 5th, 2015 at 2:16 p.m. in the afternoon. The first thing we should talk about is how often you should change your oil. Now, a good conservative rule of thumb is to change your oil every 3,000 miles. And in my Haynes service manual, that's exactly what's recommended. It recommends changing the oil every 3,000 miles or every 3 months, whichever comes first. Now, for other vehicles, it depends, you know, on what the manufacturer recommends. For example, I know someone with a 2010 VW CC, and the recommended interval for changing the oil on that vehicle is every 10,000 miles. And that person also had a 2002 Ford Thunderbird, and the recommended service interval for changing the oil on that vehicle was every 6,000 miles. Now, I used to change my oil every 3,000 miles or so, but since life can be pretty busy, I don't do it quite that often. And with my Chevy Avalanche, it has what's called an oil life indicator. And what will happen is when the computer in the truck thinks that the engine oil life is up, it will display this message. So let's go ahead and we'll turn the key in the ignition. And if you see, it says driver one. And then it says change engine oil. So whenever the truck thinks that it's time for the oil to be changed, this message will be displayed. And my truck currently has 133,422 miles on it, and the last time I changed the oil was at a mileage of 124,844 miles. So that's a difference of that's a difference of 8,578 miles, and my change engine oil message has been coming on, it first started coming on probably about 3 or 4 weeks ago, and I didn't get a chance to do my oil change until now. So it probably started coming on a few hundred miles before 133,422 miles. So let's take a rough guess that it was indicating that the oil should be changed around 133,000 miles. Okay, so on my vehicle, it's roughly gonna indicate that the oil needs to be changed about every 8,000 miles or so, and that's gonna depend on the driving conditions and my driving habits as well. If you have a vehicle that is operated under harsh conditions, like, say, for example, you're towing stuff, or you're operating a vehicle in very dusty conditions, or a lot of stop-and-go driving in heavy traffic, then you may want to change your oil more often. But as a good conservative rule of thumb to help keep your vehicle in good running order, the best thing to do is to change your oil every 3,000 miles. Another thing I wanted to point out to you is the number of hours on the engine between oil changes. Now, during the last oil change, my hour meter was at 4,365.9 hours, and it's currently at 4,623.2 hours. So that's a difference of 257.3 hours. So probably a good rule of thumb for the hours on the engine would probably be about every 250 hours. And then also one other thing that I should probably point out, which you may have noticed in some of my other videos, is that my fuel gauge is not indicating properly. It's way over to the left. So This is a problem that I'll have to fix in maybe another video. Also, the speedometer, which I'm not driving at all right now anyways, but the speedometer doesn't work at all either. And this, I think, is a common problem with 2003 Chevy Avalanches, and that's something that we can make another video about later. Okay, now I want to show you the tools and supplies which I plan on using to do the oil change. Now, first, if you're a cheapskate like me, one good thing to do is any old paper towels that you have that you've used, or any of, if you ever use those Clorox wipes or any similar wipes, you should save these, stick them in a box in your garage, and save them for whenever you're doing work on your vehicle. These things are great for additional use on your vehicle to clean up dirt and oil, and they're really tough too. Like, these things are really hard to pull apart. So I like to have some of these around. I just take the used ones that I've had, stick them in a box, and save them for whenever I'm doing repairs or maintenance on my vehicle. And then I have some old used paper towels as well. There's no need to use new ones. Your vehicle doesn't care if it's gross. It just matters if it's able to clean up the mess that you made. So save these old rags and paper towels, and you can use those to clean things up when you're working on your car. Then also, just to clean my hands if I need to, I keep some old cloth rags as well. So having a good stash of these is good. Now, these you want to store, if possible, store them in a metal bucket, because anytime you have oily rags stored somewhere, that's a big fire hazard. If you're somebody who smokes — I don't smoke, but if you're somebody who smokes, or if you're doing any welding or grinding on anything that might cause sparks to fly everywhere, if this gets into a pile, if a spark or an ash gets into a pile of oily rags, boy, you could have a big fire on your hands. So keep them in a steel bucket if you can, and also try to wash them regularly as well. And also, for the old used rags, once they get pretty dirty, make sure to throw them away. All right, the next thing is a good pair of rubber gloves, and these are some Playtex dishwashing gloves, and I've used these on a previous job and they work pretty well, and I'm going to use them on this job as well, and they seem to be pretty rugged, and I like these things, so I'm going to use these. They've got long sleeves, so they go way up your arm, and they'll help to keep the oil off. And it's best to keep the oil off whenever you're doing an oil change, because it's really not good for your body. I think it's carcinogenic possibly, but I'm not sure about that, but probably best to keep it off your skin if you can. Now, the number one safety item that you want to have are your safety glasses. Never do any work on your vehicle or any other repairs or maintenance for that matter without your safety glasses. Even if you think it's something that's very minor and you don't think you're going to get anything in your eyes, always take your safety glasses with you and use them just in case. I'll give you an example. I had to clean some corrosion off some battery terminals of one of my trucks, and I didn't think anything of it. I didn't think I'd need my safety glasses. And I was scraping the corrosion off with a little dental pick, and a little piece of corrosion flew right up into my eye. Luckily, I was able to get it out of my eye pretty easily, and it didn't do any damage, but that was a good lesson for me to always wear my safety glasses. So, number one safety item, have your safety glasses with you and wear them at all times when you're doing work on your vehicle. Now, the next thing I have is my Metrinch tool set. Now, this set of tools can be used — one tool can be used with both standard and metric nuts and bolts. And let me show you why that is. The reason why you can use these with both standard and metric nuts and bolts, you can use one tool for both, is because of this lobed profile. Instead of having, say, a profile like this 12-point box end on this wrench, which can only be used, let's see, this is a standard 7/16 wrench, combination wrench. It's got the box end here and the opened end here. This wrench can only be used on standard nuts and bolts. But this one, the Metrinch one, can be used on standard or metric nuts or bolts. Okay. Also, if you have a rounded, or if you have a nut or a bolt that the corners have been rounded off on, you can use this to get a better grip on it, because these lobes contact the face, the six faces of the nut or the bolt, instead of gripping on the corners like a 12-point socket or wrench would do. Okay, so these are really good for not only using with both standard and metric nuts and bolts, but they're also good for using with nuts and bolts whose corners have been rounded off. If you have 12-point sockets or wrenches, you may have a problem with those as well if you're trying to use it with a nut or a bolt that's been rounded off, because of the fact that it may not even be able to fit over the nut or the bolt if it's rounded off. So this again is a 12-point box, or the box, or excuse me, a 12-point box end on a combination wrench, but you also can get 6-point ones as well. All right, so those are the wrenches that I'm going to use. In fact, the specific one that I'm going to need to use to get the drain plug of my oil pan out and to drain the oil is this 15 millimeter one. And so since it's a Metrinch one, it says 15 millimeters and 19/32. Okay, so this is the one that I'm going to use, and I'll use the box end of it. We'll put those back. Now the next tools I'm going to use and I'm going to have handy are my strap wrenches. I can't remember which one that I usually use, because it's been a while since I've done my oil change, since I've changed the oil on my truck, but I'll have both of them handy. Now what these are used for, what I'll use these for, is to remove the oil filter. A strap wrench is basically, it's got a handle right here, usually a plastic or a metal handle, and a rubber strap. And that rubber strap, you can put it around, let's zoom out here a little bit, you can put it around, say, the oil filter, and then you turn, it'll grip around the oil filter, and you can turn it with the handle. So this is really good for getting around round objects like an oil filter and turning them so that you can remove them. So here's the large strap wrench that I have and the smaller one that I have. Most likely use this one, but if I have trouble getting in to the area with this tool, I'll use this smaller one. Okay, so before I remove my drain plug from my oil pan, I'll want to have my drain pan in place. Now this is just a plastic container that you can use to catch the used oil. And also there's a little area down here, right here with this little U-shaped area, and you can put the oil filter upside down in here and it'll drain down as well. And there's just a little hole for the oil to go into. And then it also has this little vent hole right here. So you want to make sure, like the cap for the vent hole on mine broke off quite a while ago, but you want to make sure if you do have a cap on your vent hole, you want to open it up so that as the oil is going into this hole here, the air can escape from this one and it doesn't bubble and splash and make a bigger mess on this end. And then there's also on these, there's a drain here too, and you can take the cap off and just pour the oil out when you need to empty the drain pan. Okay, so have this handy as well, because you'll need something to catch the oil when you drain it from the oil pan of your vehicle. So next is the oil that I'm going to use. Now, my truck takes a 5W30 oil, and what that is, see if you can see here on this bottle, let's see here, let's get a closer look. It says 5W30, and that's the viscosity of the oil, and that's basically how thick it is. If you take water, for example, water has a low viscosity, okay? So it's not very thick, and it flows fairly easily. Oil, honey, syrup, things like that have a higher viscosity, and it's harder for them to flow, and they flow more slowly. They're thicker fluids, or liquids, I should say. So all vehicles will have a rating for the viscosity of the recommended, or the recommended viscosity for the oil that they need. And in my case, for my truck, my 2003 Chevy Avalanche, the recommended viscosity is 5W30. And we'll take a look at that. I'll show you that recommendation on the oil fill cap inside the engine compartment. Now, the quantity of oil that my engine takes is 6 quarts. All right, so I had some left over. I have about a quart left over in this large container, and I bought, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 more quarts at AutoZone. All right, so I'm going to need a total of 6 quarts to fill up the engine and the new oil filter. All right, now let's go on to the oil filter itself. Okay, and I have this, what I bought was this Fram Extra Guard oil filter. All right, it's a PH3506. I usually get their tougher version, which I believe is an XG3506, but they didn't have those, so I just went with this PH3506, and I think it'll do just fine. So let's open it up and take a quick look at it. And you always want to, before you buy it, you always want to confirm the number on the actual filter. So we've got PH3506 on here. You always want to confirm that just in case somebody accidentally swaps it out for another one. As you'll see, it's got an end that's coated with this black substance, and it's kind of textured, and that gives you a little bit better grip on the end of the oil filter. But when you go to remove these things, there really isn't enough grip on there to take them out, so you definitely need to use a strap wrench. And let me grab that and I'll show you how it fits around there. Okay, so here's the oil filter, and then when I go to remove the old oil filter, I'll put this around the old oil filter. Let's see here. And then I'll tighten the strap, and then I'll just turn it counterclockwise. So remember, lefty loosey, righty tighty. So we're going to turn it lefty loosey, which is counterclockwise. I'm going to turn it like this, and that will the strap wrench should give us plenty of torque to remove the old oil filter. And then what I'll do is I'll take the old oil filter off, and I will compare it to this one just to be sure that I've got the right model, PH3506. It's the right size. I'll line up the two oil filters like I usually do, just to make sure that the sizes are the same. And I'll take a little bit of oil from the old one, and I'll wipe it around the ring of the new oil filter. Okay, so the oil, I believe, the oil goes in here and then goes through a filter element and then comes back out through these holes. I'm not sure exactly which direction it goes. I'm not sure if it goes in through these and comes out through this one or vice versa, but basically it goes in through one way and then comes out the other, and then there's a filter element inside, which you can see on this cutaway diagram here. And you'll notice this filter element is ribbed, and that gives it a larger surface area. So basically has a larger surface area folded up in here, kind of like an accordion, and that allows more oil to flow through at a faster, or it allows the oil to flow through at a faster rate versus it just being a flat, smooth cylinder of the filter element. Okay, So again, here is the new oil filter that I'll be installing. Let's go ahead and we'll put it back in the box. All right. And that's a Fram oil filter, a PH3506 again. All right, now the last thing that I like to have, and I keep several of these around, and this is an old cooking oil container, or you can use any other old plastic container, but you want to make sure that it has a good sealing lid and that it's fairly tough, because what you're going to use this for is you can take the old used oil from your drain pan and pour it into here, and then you can take it to get it recycled. And places like AutoZone and Advanced Auto Parts, and I think also Napa, will take used oil and recycle it for you. And I don't think, as far as I know, none of them charge you for that service. So keep some of these around so that you can take your used oil to have it recycled. All right, so those are the tools and supplies that I think we'll need. So now let's go take a look at the truck. Now, to get access to the engine, the first thing we'll need to do is to pop the hood. And to do that, there is a lever near the floor. Here's the little floor mat on the driver's side. And we're going to pull on this lever here. And if you look closely, there's a little icon of a car with its hood open. So this is the latch that we'll pull to release the hood. All right, and you could hear the click, hopefully, of the latch of the hood releasing. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll open up the hood and take a look inside the engine compartment. Now, after pulling that latch, or pulling that lever inside the truck, I can't just simply open the hood. If I try to lift up on it, I can't open it. You can't see that it's partway open. There's a gap here, but I can't lift it up all the way. So what I have to do next is I have to move this lever to the right. There's a lever in the center, right above the little Chevrolet bow tie there. There's a little lever in the center, just below the hood, and we're going to move that to the right, and it will release the rest of the mechanism, and then just push up on the hood, and then now we have access to the engine compartment. And the first thing I want to show you is the oil fill cap right here. And like I was saying, the recommended viscosity for this vehicle is 5W30 oil. And you can see that right here on the oil cap. It says 5W30. And it also says SAE. And what that stands for is Society of Automotive Engineers. Okay, so that's an organization of engineers, basically, who are involved in designing and building automobiles. All right, now the next thing we're going to do before we actually drain any oil is to pull out this dipstick right here and check the level of the oil. That will give us a good idea as to whether or not we have any oil leaks or if we're burning any excess oil. And we'll also take a look at the color of the oil just to see its general condition. Okay, so let's go ahead and we'll get a rag, take the dipstick out, we'll check the level, and we'll also check the quality of the oil. Now, two things that you want to do before you check the level of the oil in your engine are to let the engine sit for a while so that it will allow enough time for the oil in the engine to fully drain down into the drain pan, and you'll get a more accurate reading. Another reason is to allow the engine to cool, because when you're draining the oil out of the oil pan, you don't want scalding hot oil to be flowing out of there and getting on your skin, because that is very painful. I've done it stupidly myself, thinking that I could hurry up and take the plug out without getting any oil on me, but it's not a good idea. So always make sure to let your engine sit for a sufficient amount of time, not only to let the oil drain back down into the oil pan so that you can get an accurate reading, but also to allow the engine and the oil to cool to keep from burning yourself. So let's go ahead and I've been letting my engine sit overnight, so it's completely cool. I've got my safety gloves on, my little rubber gloves, I should say, and I'm wearing my safety glasses. So let's go ahead and we'll pull the dipstick out and we'll take a look at the level of the oil and we'll take a look at the condition of the old oil as well. I also have my old paper towel here as well. Now, it's okay if it's an old paper towel, but you don't want it to be a really dirty paper towel. You don't want it to have any dirt or sand on it because you don't want to be getting any of that into the engine. All right, so let's take out the dipstick here. And this dipstick goes down this tube and goes all the way into the oil pan at the bottom of the engine. Okay, so I'm going to take it out all the way. I'm going to wipe it off once. Okay. In fact, before we put it back in there, let's take a look. And you can see at the end of the dipstick, you can see a series of holes, and then also this cross-hatched pattern or diagonal pattern in the end of the dipstick. And what that does is that little cross-hatched area indicates where the oil level should be when the engine is properly filled with the right amount of oil. So, and if you see on the other side, there's no crosshatch pattern, but that's not a big deal. But here's the crosshatch pattern on this side, and you want to make sure that when you pull the dipstick out, the level of oil comes up to somewhere in that crosshatched area. So let's go ahead and we'll put it down into the tube again. And this time I'm not going to wipe it off because I want to see at what level the oil is. So here it is. You can see that it's coming up to just near the bottom of the dipstick right there. Okay, so it's pretty good, I'd say. And when we do the oil change after we've drained the oil and filled it up with new oil, we'll let the engine run a little bit and then let it sit for a little while longer after we shut it off. Let the new oil drain back down into the oil pan of the engine, and then we'll check the oil level again just to make sure it's within this cross-hatched area. Now, in addition to checking the level of the oil, you want to also check the quality. Now, this looks typical for used oil right before an oil change. It's a little darker than it normally would be, or actually it's fairly darker than new oil would be. New oil is kind of a clearish brown color typically, but this is pretty close to it. Some of the things that you want to check for though, you want to make sure that the oil isn't completely black. That's a sign that you probably waited too long to change the oil, or you may have some other problems going on inside your engine. You also want to make sure it's not a milky color. Okay, if it looks like it's milky, if it's a, you know, like a whitish or tannish color, that can be an indication that there's water in the oil, and that could be from a coolant leak inside the engine. Possibly antifreeze and water are seeping into the oil because there's a leak in the coolant system. So you want to make sure that it doesn't have a milky consistency either. Also, for those of you who like to go off-roading, whenever you go off-roading, if you've gone through water and it's come up to the engine, it's always a good practice to just change your oil, because there's a good chance that oil could have gotten into the engine and you don't want to let it sit there. So you want to change the oil as soon as you can once you've gone off-roading so that you have good fresh oil in there and it's not, you know, that milky colored oil like I was talking about. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll put this back in the little tube for the dipstick. All right, so now let's go down below and we'll go ahead and we'll drain the oil. Now, ideally when you're doing an oil change, the best thing to have is a lift, so that you can just lift the vehicle up over your head and do the oil change while you're standing up. But since most people don't have a lift, you have to do something else to get underneath your vehicle. And typically what you'll have to do is get on the ground and slide under it. So I don't have any room on my driveway right now to work on my vehicle, so I'm doing this in my yard. But to make the job easier and to make myself more comfortable, I've taken these old sheets of plywood and I've slid them underneath my truck. Now that'll make it so that I'm less likely to get attacked by bugs, and also less likely to get poked by things like sand spurs, which I have in my yard. I've also put a sheet of cardboard under there to catch any oil that may spill, so that it doesn't get on my plywood, and it'll just soak up the oil, and then I can just throw the cardboard out. So when you're working on your vehicle, and if you don't have a lift, and if you don't really want to put the vehicle up on, say, jack stands or anything like that, well, even if you have it up on jack stands, it's a good idea to put something like plywood or cardboard or even an old sheet down on the ground to make yourself more comfortable and to keep from getting bitten up by little critters on the ground or getting poked by things. So there's another tip for you. And now we'll go and take a look underneath the truck. All right, so now I'm underneath my truck, and let me show you what we're going to be working on here to do the oil change. First thing I'm looking at here, which I'm going to have to unscrew, is the drain plug and the oil pan. Here's the oil pan, and basically it's just a container on the bottom of the engine to catch and hold the oil that circulates through the engine. So the oil is stored here. When you start up the engine, the oil pump will suck the oil up from the oil pan and circulate it throughout the engine. It'll also flow through the oil filter here, which we'll be removing, and then it goes back into the oil pan, I believe, and then back through the engine. So basically it circulates throughout the engine, it goes through the oil filter, and it also is stored in the oil pan here. So to drain the oil from the oil pan, we're gonna turn this bolt counterclockwise. Remember, lefty loosey, righty tighty. So we're gonna turn it this way to unscrew it. Now, before I was showing you that I'm gonna use my 15 millimeter mesh wrench combination wrench. I'm gonna use the box end. And to remind myself what size I'm going to need to use, during an earlier oil change, I took, I think it was a nail or something, and I scraped 15 mm on the bottom of the oil pan for 15 millimeter to remind myself that it's a 15 millimeter combination wrench that I need to use, so that I don't have to fumble through different wrench sizes to get the right one. I know it's going to be a 15 millimeter each time I need to change my oil and take this drain plug out. Okay, so we're going to take that drain plug out. We're also going to take out the oil filter here. And again, it's got this, the old one has this black coating on it, but I know from experience that I don't think I'm going to be able to get a good enough grip on it just with that coating to unscrew the oil filter. So I'm gonna have to use my strap wrench to get that baby out of there, because when you put them on, when you put a new oil filter on, you only wanna screw it on hand tight. You don't wanna use the strap wrench to screw it on. But during use, while the engine is running and after heating up and cooling down and stuff, it causes it to stick on there much more. So usually with pretty much every engine I've ever done an oil change on, I think I've always had to use something that would give me better leverage than just using my hands to get the oil filter off. I don't think I've ever really been able to get the oil filter off just by unscrewing it with my hands. I've always in most cases had to use a tool such as a strap wrench or an oil filter socket to get the oil filter off. Okay, so there it is. There's the oil filter and there's the drain plug, and we're gonna take both of those out and drain out the old oil. Okay, so I'm underneath my truck. I've got my drain pan, which when you have your drain pan, make sure the drain pan is empty. You don't want to be draining the oil into a drain pan that's already full. You want to make sure that the plug in the center is out so that the oil can drain into the drain pan and into the compartment under the drain pan. And you also want to make sure that the vent hole on the side of the drain pan is open so that the air can escape and the oil won't bubble and make more of a mess. Okay, so I'm going to take my 15 millimeter combination, the box end on my 15 millimeter combination wrench. Okay, and I'm going to turn this bolt in the bottom of the oil pan, take it out, and let the oil drain out of the engine. And remember, I want to turn it lefty-loosey or counterclockwise. So I'm going to turn it this way. Let's see if I can get enough leverage on it here. There we go. Okay, so I'll just turn it once more with my wrench. I'll make sure that the oil pan is positioned properly underneath the the oil drain pan is positioned properly under the oil drain hole. I also have some cardboard underneath there to catch any splashes, hopefully. So let's go ahead and remove it, and remember to make sure that the engine has cooled down completely so that you don't get hot oil on yourself and scald yourself. Okay, and as I'm turning the bolt counterclockwise, I'm also pressing in on it to make it less likely for the oil to leak out until I'm ready to pull it completely out of the hole. Okay, so now it's starting to drain, and let's pop it out of there. Okay, so there we go. And don't drop the bolt into your drain pan because it may go inside it and it'll be hard to get it out of there. So I'm going to leave the oil on the bolt as well so that we can take a look at this bolt, because there's a little magnet on the end of the bolt, I believe, and that helps to collect any metal shavings that may be in the oil. Okay, so let's take a closer look at the bolt as the oil is draining out of the engine. Okay, so here's the bolt for the drain pan in the engine. And as you can see, it's got a little rubber gasket here. It's got its threads. And then on the end, that is a little magnet, I believe, and that will help to catch and hold any metal shavings that may be in the engine. And you want to inspect that. And on mine, I haven't cleaned it off yet, and so it looks good. I don't see any metal shavings, so that's a good sign right there, because if you see metal shavings in there, that can be a sign of excessive wear on the inside of your engine. And let's just for fun, let's see if it actually is magnetic, which I think it is. Let's see if it sticks to the metal on the bumper. Yep, sure enough, that's definitely magnetic. I got a little oil on my bumper there, but that's all right, I'll wipe it off. So here's the bolt that I had to take out to drain the oil from the oil pan of the engine into the drain pan that I have down below. Okay, so let's clean that off and we'll put it to the side and we'll take the oil filter off next. Okay, so now what I'm gonna do is take the oil filter off, and I'm gonna turn it lefty-loosey, so I'm gonna turn it counterclockwise. And here's the oil filter right here. And I don't think I'm gonna even bother trying to turn it with my hand, because I don't think I've ever been able to do it before without using the strap wrench. So here's the strap wrench right here. I'm gonna go ahead and use the larger one, so that'll give me more leverage and it'll make it easier to remove it. Let's go ahead and I'll put it around the oil filter. Try to position it so that I can turn the so that I can move the wrench and turn the filter. Might have to do it a little bit at a time. We need to tighten up the strap on the strap wrench. Get it good and tight, and get it underneath the teeth of the strap wrench. And let's go ahead and try to turn it here. Make sure I've got my oil pan positioned under there, and try to still keep it underneath the hole for the oil pan, because that I don't have the bolt back in there yet, so it's still dripping. So let's go ahead and see if we can turn it and loosen it. Let's see here. I think it slipped off there. Have to slide it back on there again. Let's get it around there. Turn it up just a bit. Flip it over the filter a little bit better. Okay, I think that should be good. Let's tighten it up. Let's see. It's a little hard to see right here. Let me move a little bit more. Okay. Try again. Kind of hard to do this when you're filming as well, because I'm trying to make it so that you can see what I'm doing at the same time, and so it's a little awkward in this position. All right, so let's try one more time. Alright, I think it's, yeah, now it's turning. Okay, so this is the really messy part, is trying to get this thing off without getting oil all over yourself. So, let me continue to loosen it here with the strap wrench. I think that's probably good enough right now. And then I'll take it the rest of the way off with my hand here. And the oil's starting, I think the oil's starting to come out now. Yep, let's move the drain pan, make sure it's catching everything. I've got my hand positioned kind of high, so that hopefully it won't drain down my arm here. And as you can see, this is pretty messy. Oil gets all over the place. It's about the only way that you can do it. I don't think there's much of an alternative. I'll turn it over and then just place it in the drain pan. And I've got some of my rags handy here so that I can wipe off my gloves and I don't get oil all over the place, hopefully. Okay. Alright, so I'll just drop that into the oil pan there. And then let's we'll take a quick look at where, we'll take a quick look at where the oil filter mounts on the engine. Okay, so here is a view of what it looks like on the engine where the oil filter mounts or screws onto. Let me see if I can get my arm over here. The little portion in the center is threaded, and that's where the oil filter screws onto. And then there is a flat surface here, which I'll clean off, and that's where the seal of, that's what the seal of the oil filter mates with to seal the system up and prevent the oil from leaking. So you want to make sure that you clean this off and make sure that it's not damaged at all. Make sure that it doesn't have any dents or dings or scratches in it, because that can result in an oil leak. But I've never ever seen an issue with these mating surfaces here. So again, this is the position on the engine where the oil filter screws onto. Okay, so there's the old oil filter down there, and we'll take a look at it and compare it to the new one. Alright, so I've got the old oil filter off, so let's go ahead and compare it to the new oil filter. Now, the old oil filter obviously is the one on the left, and here's the new one. They're both Fram oil filters, but the old one is an XG3506, and I wanted to put one of these back on there for this oil change, but they didn't have them at AutoZone when I went there to get my oil and my oil filter. So that's all right, it's no big deal. I'm just gonna use this PH3506 and that should work, and I don't think it'll be a big deal. So let's take a look at the size. They're the same size. They look like they're the same diameter. Okay, another thing you want to do is also check to make sure that the seal came off with the oil filter. Okay, you want to make sure that the old seal isn't still on the engine block. And we just looked at the engine block previously, and we could see that the old seal wasn't on there any longer. So just as a reminder, make sure that the old seal is not still on the engine block and that it's on the old oil filter. Okay, so let's hold them next to each other, and you can see that they're the same in diameter. All right, so I think we've got a good match. It's a slightly different model, but I've used this PH3506 oil filter before on my truck, and I know it works. So there we go. Now let's take the new one, and we'll screw it onto the engine block. And when we put it on there, we want to make sure we just put it on there as tight as we can get it. You want to make sure you put it on there as tight as you can get it with your hand. Don't use a strap wrench or any other tool to tighten it on there, because that'll make it too tight. You just want to get it just tight enough, or get it as tight as you can with your hand. And in fact, one thing I just noticed is that it has these little arrows here, and that tells you the direction to turn the oil filter when you're putting it on. So we want to turn it clockwise, or righty tighty. So let's go ahead and we'll put it on the engine block. Okay, so I'll take one of my rags, stick it on the end of my finger right here, and I'll clean off the mating surface on the engine block that the seal of the oil filter will touch. Clean that off, and now I'll go ahead and I'll take the oil filter and I'll screw it on to the engine block, and we're gonna turn it clockwise, or righty-tighty, and I only want to tighten it with my hand. I only want to get it as tight as I can with my hand. I don't want to use any tools to tighten it, because that will put it on there too tight. And again, I'll also get a little bit of oil that's dripping out of the engine, and I'll put it on the seal first before I screw it on there. So let's get a little bit of the oil that's dripping out of the oil pan. Let's see if you can see that there. I'll put it on the seal. Hopefully you can see that somewhat. Put it around the seal. And then I'll screw it on to the engine block. And again, we're gonna do righty-tighty. We're gonna turn it on clockwise. And I only wanna tighten it with my hand. I only wanna get it as tight as I can with my hand. Alright, so we'll clean it up a little bit. I'll clean it up a little bit with a rag. Just get any of the excess oil off of there. Then I'll go get the drain plug and reinstall that. Okay, so here's my drain plug right here. I've cleaned it off. I'll clean off the mating surface as well that it goes to. Okay, and then I'll screw that back into the drain hole. In the crankcase. Or the drain pan, I mean. And we want to turn it clockwise or righty-tighty. Alright, so I've got it in there as tight as I can with my fingers. And you always want to start a nut or a bolt, actually bolts mainly, with your fingers so that you don't cross-thread them. Cross-threading is when the threads of a bolt cut into the corresponding threads in the hole that the bolt's being screwed into, or in a nut as well. So you want, the best way to keep from cross-threading something is to screw it in by hand first, get it started by hand, and then turn it the rest of the way and fully tighten it with your tool. So, and in this case, the tool I'm going to use is my, let's see here, let's see if you can see it, my 15 millimeter combination metrinch wrench. Okay, and there may be a specific torque for this. I don't know what it is. I just generally tighten it with, by hand and get it good and tight. Okay, so there we go. We're pretty much done down below here. Now we need to fill the engine up with oil. Okay, it's Sunday, September 6th, 2015, at 12:10 p.m. in the afternoon. And we're back up top and ready to fill the engine up with new oil. Now, the first thing we want to do is to clean the oil fill cap off so that we can take it off. So I've got one of my old paper towels here, and I'll use that to clean off the dirt that may be on top of the oil fill cap, because we don't want to get any dirt in there. So let's clean that off. All right, so that's good and clean. And then now all we have to do is turn it counterclockwise, so lefty-loosey. Just turn it a bit and then pull it straight off. And so there we go. Now, when we take it off, what we want to do is we also want to inspect the seal around it. And there's a little O-ring. And that looks like it's in pretty good condition. It's a little dirty, so I'll wipe it off, but it's in fairly good condition. I don't see any cracks on there, and it's in place. Okay, if it was missing or if it was cracked, you'd want to replace it. Now, another tool that I forgot to mention at the beginning of the video, which you're going to need, is a funnel. A funnel will help you to pour the oil into the oil fill hole right here. It's kind of a small hole, so it may be a little tricky to get the oil in there by just pouring the oil directly in by itself. You may end up spilling it. So you're going to want to have a funnel. Now, here's a little tip for you fellow cheapskates out there. Instead of buying a funnel, take an old plastic water, juice, or soda bottle and cut the top of it off. And they make excellent funnels. So I have one here. This is cut off an old water bottle, and it's just got the top of the water bottle here, and then just a small section of the wide portion of the water bottle. And these things work really, really well, and they fit into most of the fill holes on your vehicle very well also. So if you look here, fits really nice in the fill hole for the oil. I'll bring it over here for the fill hole for the coolant reservoir. It fits well in there. And then also, you can use it to fill up the liquid for your windshield wipers, your windshield wiper fluid. And then over here, it fits well in the fill hole for the brake fluid reservoir. And then my truck, I don't have a typical radiator cap that's easily accessible like on most vehicles, but I've tried these types of funnels on the little fill hole for radiators as well, and they fit great, and pretty much everyone I've ever tried seems to fit really well. So instead of buying a funnel, keep some of these lying around in your vehicle and also in your garage, and they're great free funnels that you can use. And if you lose it, no big deal. You just get another one whenever you get a water bottle and just cut it up. All right, so there's a little tip for you cheapskates out there. Okay, so I've got my funnel placed in the oil fill hole of the engine and I'm ready to go. But one more thing you want to do before you start filling up the engine with oil is to double check to make sure that you've put the drain plug back in and it's secure, and that you've also screwed the oil filter back on to, or the new oil filter onto the engine, and that it's secure, because once you start pouring oil in there, it's going to drain down into the oil pan, and if that drain plug's not in there, or if the oil filter is not in there, chances are you're probably going to have a big mess on the ground. So double check, make sure you have put the drain plug back in the oil pan and have screwed the new oil filter onto the engine. All right, now the oil that I'm going to use, I didn't talk about this at the beginning, but I did say that I'm going to use a viscosity of 15W30, but I'm also using a synthetic oil. So this is Mobil 1 Extended Performance, and it says, let's see here, Advanced Full Synthetic Motor Oil. Okay, now I haven't done any scientific testing of this myself, but I've always heard that synthetic oil is better for your engine and that it will last longer, so that's why I'm using this. It does cost more than typical oil, but I'm hoping this will allow my engine to last longer and result in less wear on the engine. Okay, so what I'm gonna do, my engine, again, it requires, let's see, a total of 6 quarts of oil. So in each one of these containers is 1 US quart. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna fill up the engine with 5 quarts of oil, then I'm gonna start it up, let it run a little bit, and that will allow some of the oil to get into, it'll allow the oil to fill up the oil filter, and then I'll put in about another quart, and I'll also check the level of it as well, because you don't wanna underfill the oil, and you also don't want to overfill the oil, because if you overfill it, that can cause foaming of the oil if it gets up into the crankshaft, and the crankshaft can kind of stir it up and cause bubbles and cause it to foam. So you don't want to overfill it and you don't want to underfill the oil. All right, so let's go ahead and we'll put one of these quarts in there and I'll show you what it looks like. So I'll go ahead and take off the cap. And I've got my gloves on. I also have my safety glasses on. Always do this with your safety glasses. It's not too big of a deal if you don't have gloves, but it's probably better to have gloves. And let's see here. It's kind of a good idea to pour it from the side, because it seems to result in less chugging, or less bubbling, I guess you could say, as it's pouring in. The air has plenty of room to go in as the oil is flowing out. Okay. And hopefully you can see the color of the oil. It's kind of maybe an amber color. It's transparent and kind of a brownish amber color. Let's do it from this angle too, just in case. Couldn't see it well from that angle. And as you can see, that funnel makes it easier to get it to go into the hole. It's just a larger hole going down into a smaller one. And what I like to do is I like to set the water, or excuse me, I like to set the bottle of oil upside down in the funnel, let it drain the last little bit out of it while I'm getting the next bottle ready. Okay, so I'll do the next one here. Screw off the cap. Tap off the last little bit that's left in there. put it aside. And we'll start with the next bottle of oil. Let me do it from this side here. Hopefully you can get a better view. And hopefully I don't miss. There we go. And you can hopefully get a good idea of the color of the new oil. Okay, so we'll let it sit there and drain. I'll get the next bottle ready. Oops. It's no big deal if you spill a little bit, but and you can just clean it up. So if you balance it just right there, it should drain. But what I'll do is I've already put 2 quarts in there, so I'll put another 3 quarts in for a total of 5. Then what I'll do is I'll start the engine, let the oil circulate through and fill up the oil filter, and then I'll check the level and then add another quart so that it fills the engine up with enough oil to set the oil level in between that, somewhere inside that crosshatch pattern that I was showing you on the oil dipstick. Okay, so I want to make a correction. When I was filling up the first 2 quarts of oil, I mistakenly said that the viscosity of the oil is 15W30, but it's actually 5W30. So just wanted to correct myself there. And I wanted to give you another tip for when you're doing your oil change. Now, you may be in a hurry and you want to, you know, get things cleaned up as you're going along, but when you're filling up your engine with oil, don't throw the bottles of oil away as you're filling it up. Make sure you either put them, you know, on the side of the engine compartment, or better yet, just put them down lined up next to each other on the ground, so that if you get distracted, you'll be able to go back to the bottles and tell how much you've actually filled up in the engine so far. You won't have to try to guess and figure it out. You'll know exactly what you put in so far, just in case you get distracted and you lose count. So far I put in, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 quarts, and I've got another about another quart left in this container here. And if you can see, a little bit down at the bottom. I think that's about a quart probably. Let's see, this thing holds 5 quarts. And let's just count the, just for fun, let's count the marks on the side. Let's see. Yeah, so this is, if you see down on the right, that's the quart mark. So let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, and, you know, probably somewhere up here is 5. So if I hold it level, I've got probably a little less than a quart in there. So, but before I put this in there, what I'm going to do is I'm going to crank the engine, let it run for a little while, check the level of the oil again, and then fill it up the rest of the way. So let's go ahead and do that. Now, before I go ahead and crank up the engine, I want to first take the funnel back out. Take that out, and I'll set it on an old paper towel. Okay, I want to put the oil cap back on. And let's see here. Turn it righty-tighty, or clockwise. All right, make sure it's good and secure. All right, I don't think any oil's probably going to come out of there anyways once we start the engine, but it's a good idea just to be cautious. Okay, also, if you spill a few drops of oil on the engine when you're filling it up, that's not too big of a deal. But if you spill a lot, you want to make sure you clean up that excess oil, especially because the exhaust is right underneath where you will be filling the oil. So if oil gets on the exhaust manifold or any of the other hot parts of the engine, you could get smoking and also have a potential fire hazard. So if you get more than just a few drops on there, you want to clean it up thoroughly with a rag. All right, so now the next thing we want to do is we want to clear everything out of the engine compartment. Like this rag here, I'll move this out of the way, the funnel and the old paper towels, and let's just thoroughly inspect the engine compartment, make sure everything is back together. If we had any of the other, if we were doing any other work, you know, make sure we have all the fill caps on, make sure we have everything else back in place. Make sure there are no tools in the engine compartment, and especially make sure that if anybody's helping you, that they're clear of the engine as well. Okay, so let's go ahead and we'll crank the engine up, let the new oil circulate through the engine a little bit, and also fill up the oil filter. Then we'll shut it off, let it sit for a little while, and check the oil level again with the dipstick right here. Okay, I cranked the engine and let it run for a few seconds. I shut it off and it's been sitting for a while now, probably about 20 minutes or so, as I did other things. And so now let's go ahead and we'll check the current level of the oil in the engine using the dipstick. Now, I have my safety glasses on again, and even though this is probably an operation that you think you might not need your safety glasses, in some instances, you know, you may end up where dipstick can accidentally flick oil into your eye as you're taking it out, or you know, under other circumstances. So make sure you have your safety glasses on, and also if you have a pair, have your gloves on as well. And I do have to say that these things, these Playtex dishwashing gloves, are really good. Usually I've used latex or nitrile surgical gloves in the past, and those things almost always break after, you know, just using them a few times for a few different operations. But these things are really tough and they haven't broken at all, haven't gotten any holes in them, and so I'd highly recommend getting a pair of these to keep your hands clean. So let's go ahead and check the engine oil level and also take a look to see what the oil looks like on the dipstick as far as color goes. I've got my old paper towel here, and again, you want to make sure that, you know, it's okay to have an old paper towel that maybe you've used while you're eating or something, but make sure it doesn't have any sand or any dirt on it, because you don't want to get any of that into the engine. So let's take the dipstick out. We'll wipe it down once. Okay. Put it back into the tube for the dipstick, and then take a look at it. And again, we don't want to wipe the end off. We just want to look to see at about what level it's at. And maybe a little hard to see in the camera, but it looks like, even though there's some along the edge, I believe it came up to just the bottom of the crosshatched area. So unless it's completely covering the dipstick, only go to the level at which it completely covers it. If it's kind of on the side, well, that's just some oil that was left on the side of the tube, of the dipstick tube that got on the dipstick. But you really want to look, the true indication of the level of the engine oil is the point at which it comes up to and it's completely covered the dipstick. And so that's about right here, right around near that first hole on the left. Okay, so it's just at the bottom of the crosshatched area, and I think if we fill it up with one more quart, we should be good to go. And if you notice, take a look at the color. It's quite a bit lighter than the used oil that we had looked at previously. So that's the way new oil should look typically after you do an oil change. Okay, so let's go ahead and we'll put it back in the dipstick tube. Okay, so I've put a total of 6 quarts of oil into the engine now. I've taken the funnel out of the oil fill hole. I put the cap back on the oil fill hole. I double checked again to make sure I don't have anything in the engine compartment that might fall down into the engine and get caught up in there. Everything's back in place, so let's go ahead and we'll crank it up, let it run for a little while, and we'll also check underneath for any leaks. Okay, so the engine is running, and what I want to do is I want to look underneath the truck and see if I notice any leaks. Now, if you're on a concrete surface that's fairly clean, it'll probably be pretty easy to tell whether or not you have any leaks because it'll be easy to see the spots on the concrete. But if you're over just bare ground like grass like I am, or dirt, or if you're in a parking spot that is on, say, asphalt or concrete that's really dirty and has a lot of other oil spots on it, it's going to be kind of hard to tell whether or not you're leaking any oil. So a good tip is to, like in my case, I put down some plywood. So if I had any drops of oil coming down from the engine, I'd be able to see them really easily on the plywood, which I don't see anything right now. I think it looks pretty good. Or you can put, say, an old sheet, or even better yet, just some old cardboard down underneath your engine. Make sure the cardboard is clean, and that'll be a really easy way to tell if you have an oil leak, because you know, the oil will fall on the cardboard or the old sheet, and you'll notice it right away. So again, let's just take a close-up look, see if we have any oil dripping down from the engine. See a little dirt over there, but I think that's okay. That's not definitely not from the engine, and I think we're good to go underneath. All right, so let's shut it off and let it sit for a little while again while we're cleaning up, and we'll just double check the oil level to make sure it's right. Okay, so we have a full 6 quarts of oil in the engine now. I let it run again to circulate the oil through the engine one more time. I've let it, I turned it off and I've let it sit again for probably about 15 or 20 minutes. And then now let's go ahead and we'll check the final level of the oil inside the engine. Let's take out the dipstick. We'll wipe it off. Put it back into the dipstick tube. Insert it all the way down to the bottom so that you get an accurate reading. Pull it all the way out, and then let's check it again. Okay, so let's see here. Now if you look, hopefully you can see it. Well, the oil covers the dipstick just up to right around. It completely covers the dipstick, I'd say, probably right around up to this second hole from the right. So we're well within the crosshatched pattern that we need to be. It's probably ends right around here. Now we do have some farther up the dipstick, but that is probably oil again that was on the side of the dipstick tube and just got onto the dipstick as we were pulling it out. So I'd say we're probably right around here at this hole, which is the second hole from the right. So the oil level looks good, and we'll go ahead and reinsert the dipstick into the dipstick tube. I'll wipe it off again as well. Now the next thing that we have to do is get in the truck and reset the oil life indicator, or it's also called the oil life monitor. A lot of older vehicles don't have this feature, but on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche, it has it, and most newer vehicles have this feature as well. And basically what it does is the PCM, or the powertrain control module, it will monitor your driving habits and the condition of the engine, and it will give you an estimate of when you need to change your oil. And again, that's indicated when you turn on the ignition. So let's turn it on. And I didn't crank it, I just turned the key to the run position. And as you can see, it still says change engine oil. Okay, now to reset that on a 2003 Chevy Avalanche, here we've got the hour meter again. Again, it's the hour meter is at 4,623.2 hours. And again, for your reference, today is Sunday, September 6th, 2015. And again, I have a 2003 Chevy Avalanche. Let's see the mileage. The mileage is 133,422 miles. Okay, so that's a good reference for you. But again, to reset the oil life monitor or oil life indicator on a 2003 Chevy Avalanche, what you want to do is turn the key to the run position. Don't start it, just turn it to the run position, and press the gas pedal three times quickly and let it go. So we're going to turn it to the run position, press down on the gas pedal, let it go, press down again, let it go, press down again, let it go, and then we should get a message indicating that the oil life has been reset. So let's go ahead and do that. I've got the key completely off. I've got my foot over the gas pedal. Let's turn it to the run position. One, two, three. And let's see if it tells me that the oil life, okay, so there we go, oil life reset. And that's what you want to see. That indicates that the oil life indicator or oil life monitor has been reset. And it will start, as soon as you start driving again, it'll start accumulating time on the oil and mileage, and it will calculate based on your driving conditions when you need to change the oil again. And you'll get another message eventually after, say, around 8,000 miles that the engine oil should be changed. Now, one other thing that you can do on a Chevy Avalanche and on most other vehicles is to check the oil pressure. So let's go ahead and start the engine. Again, you want to make sure that, we've got it in park. I'm going to set the emergency brake right here. Push it down with my foot. Okay. And let's crank it up and watch the oil pressure gauge and make sure that it comes up to the proper level. All right. Again, it says oil life reset. And my oil pressure gauge looks good. It typically is vertical here at around the 40 mark. Okay, so as you're driving your vehicle around and it's in good running condition, get an idea, look at all of your gauges and get an idea of what they typically look like when the engine is running properly. Okay, now on my vehicle, the oil pressure gauge is typically straight up. The voltmeter is typically straight up. Sometimes it'll be, down a little bit less than 14 volts. But typically right here, and to get a more accurate reading, you want to look at it head on so that you don't have what's called parallax error, which is where if, like say for example, I'm looking at it straight on here and it's right on the 14 volt mark, but if I bring the camera over to the side, it looks like it's on one of the marks over towards the right of the 14. Okay, so that's called parallax error, and you want to look at it straight on preferably. Alright, the same goes for the oil pressure gauge. So it's just under 40, and that's the typical position that it's in. And then as the engine gets hotter, the temperature gauge will come up, and I believe on mine it's typically at around 210 degrees Fahrenheit. Alright, my fuel gauge is screwed up, so I've got to fix that later on. And then also you want to look to see if you have any other indicators on your dashboard that indicate a problem. Now my I believe the check engine light is on, but I think that's probably just because of the gas cap not being on tight at one point, and that needs to be reset. On these vehicles, if you don't screw the gas cap on completely, that can cause a pressure problem in the fuel system, and it will turn on the check engine light, and you just have to reset it with a little interface to the powertrain control module, or the engine control module. So there we go, the engine's running. Again, the oil pressure looks good. Let's look at it straight on. Yep, looks good. Okay, voltmeter's good, temperature's coming up. And so I think we're done with the oil change. The only other thing I'll do is probably dump the oil out of my drain pan and stick it into a jug and then just take it to be recycled. Okay, now one thing I noticed as I was looking at this box for the new oil filter, the new Fram PH3506 oil filter that I purchased, is that it says proven protection up to 5,000 miles or 8,000 kilometers. So just to be on the safe side, instead of waiting for my oil life indicator to tell me when it's time to change the oil, I'll do another oil change in about 5,000 miles, just to be on the safe side. I think the XG3506 has a higher mileage rating than this one, but since I wasn't able to get one of those, and I only was able to get the PH3506, I'm going to try to be a little conservative and go ahead and change the oil in about 5,000 miles from now. So I just wanted to make that note. Okay, so now that you've done the oil change, now once you're done taking out the old oil and filling up the engine with new oil, you'll want to do something with the old oil. So in most cases, you'll probably just want to recycle it. And the easiest way to do that is to just take it to an auto parts store like AutoZone, Advanced Auto Parts, or NAPA, and have them recycle it. And as far as I know, again, like I said, I don't think any of those places charge you to take the old oil. So we'll just take it from the drain pan here. Now I want to make sure that the vent hole is open on the drain pan, so it'll make it easier to flow into the container that I'm going to put it in. And I'll just take the cap off, and it's a good idea to do it over the grass or over the dirt, because if you do it over your driveway or over you know, any other paved surface, if you spill it, it's going to get all over it. If it gets a little on the ground, it's not too big of a deal. So let's take off the cap, pick it up, and just pour it from the little spout into the container. Okay, so I'll put the cap back on, and notice I've got my gloves on and my safety glasses. All right, and Jen just put the cap back on there, and then you can, you know, maybe put it in a plastic bag or a cardboard box, stick it in the back of your truck or in the trunk of your car, and take it to be recycled. Another thing you can do with old oil is take it, get like a 5-gallon bucket, fill it with some sand, put some oil in there, and then when you're using yard tools like your shovel, once you're done using the tool, you can take it and you can jab it down into that bucket full of oily sand. It'll help to clean some of the corrosion off the shovel, and it'll also oil up the shovel for you. You can also take the old oil, put it on other tools like hedge clippers, hose, and other garden tools. You can also use it for the blade of your lawnmower, things like that. You know, just maybe put it on an oily rag and wipe it over the blades. I myself have a reel mower, and I use that. I take some of the old oil and I just wipe it on the blades of the reel mower once I'm done mowing, and it does a good job of preventing corrosion and also lubricating the hardware as well. Okay, so I'll go ahead and I'll take this and recycle it. Okay, another tip I wanted to, actually two more tips I wanted to give you regarding these drain pans is, if you can, when you're not using it, store it in your garage or someplace that's covered and sheltered from the rain. If you can't store it in your garage or, you know, under, like in a shed or under something that's sheltered from the rain, what you want to do is take, put the cap, screw the cap in for the center. Okay, make sure you got the cap on the end of the drain spout. And mine doesn't have a cap for the vent because that broke off a long time ago. But if you have a cap for the vent, close that. And then just put it upside down on the ground. All right, and that will prevent rain from accumulating in it, because while it's sitting outside, and if it's sitting up like this, you're gonna end up getting rain leaking down into your drain pan, and then you're just gonna have a bunch of oily water in there that you'll have to get rid of later. And when you go to get rid of that oily water, the auto parts stores don't like that stuff. So what'll happen is when you fill up the jug with that oily water, the oil and the water will separate, and the guys at the auto parts store, if they see that, they won't let you bring the oil in if they notice that it has water in it. So one little trick to kind of get around that is you can right after you get to the auto parts store, but before you go in there to recycle it, you can just shake the bottle up and let the water and the oil mix. And they are less likely to notice it, and they'll be more likely to let you recycle it. And it's not that big of a deal. It's all dirty, oily gunk anyways, and they're going to recycle it, and it'll get cleaned up in the end anyways. So that's one little tip for you. You want to make sure that water doesn't accumulate in your drain pan. And if you do have water that gets in there, and you pour it into your jug and it looks like there's a oil and water in there, just shake it up right before you take it into the store, and they'll be a lot less likely to, you know, tell you that you can't recycle it. Okay, everyone, before I wrap things up for this oil change on my 2003 Chevy Avalanche, I wanted to mention three other tips for you. The first one is storage of old oil and oil filters. If you're going to store the old oil and the old oil filters for a while, try not to keep the plastic containers, if you have them in plastic containers, out in the sun, because over time those containers can get brittle and very weak, and you may go to pick it up and that container may break and you'll get oil or oil filters all over the place and have a big mess. So try not to store them in the sun if possible. Try to keep them in your shed or in your garage, and better yet, just, you know, get rid of them. Now, I did mention that you can recycle your oil at auto parts stores like Advanced Auto Parts, AutoZone, and NAPA. But as far as I know, at least the ones in my area, they will not take the oil filters. So to recycle those, you'll probably need to contact either your city recycling department or your county recycling department, and hopefully one of those will be willing to take the old oil filters. Now, the third thing I wanted to mention is for those of you who like to go off-roading. Now, previously I mentioned that if you go off-roading and you go in water, you want to change your oil right away after you're done, so that you don't have water inside your engine. Now, the same thing applies for your differential. You'll probably, if you've got a four-wheel drive vehicle, you'll have a differential in the front and in the rear. Your transfer case, which is the assembly that allows power to be taken from the engine and sent to both ends of the vehicle, both the front wheels and the rear wheels, okay? Your transmission, and then also you'll want to, you want to change the fluids on all of those, your engine, your transmission, your transfer case, and your differentials. And you'll also want to re-grease the fittings on your suspension, and if possible, it's best, at least what I found, is to use excuse me, marine grease, because as far as I know, marine grease is less likely to be washed off and displaced by water. So I like to use marine grease when I'm greasing the fittings on my suspension and my steering. Also, for the bearings on your vehicle, the wheel bearings and bearings that you may have in your differential or any other part of the drivetrain, if you go to pack those bearings, it's best to pack them with marine grease. So before you go off-roading, a good idea is to pack those bearings with marine grease and also make sure that you have new seals. I'll give you an example. On one of my vehicles, my Ford F-150, I had to totally reassemble the front portion of the four-wheel drive drivetrain because one of the seals leaked. Water got in there when I was going off-roading, and I stupidly didn't change the oil or change the grease and repack the bearing. So I had to redo all of that assembly. But when I redid it, I did it with marine grease, and I put new seals in everything as well. So you want to be conscious of that if you're going to be going off-roading and going in water or mud, because the water or the mud can get in to those assemblies, like your transmission, your differential, your transfer case, your wheel bearings, your suspension, etc., and it can cause a lot of problems and a lot of damage. So just keep that in mind. All right, everyone, that's it. Thanks for watching, and I hope you learned something.